Okay, so I will speak about the prediction of local rainfall, at least what we can predict, even at local scale. So I just begin by an infrared image of the last week. It was 5 or 6 days ago. You take the...
From
a
deck.
Okay. I don't see it.
Oh, sorry.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, so it is just an image of the last week, so it's basically early night, so you recognize Indonesia. So we can see that the convection, the deep convection, is organized by scales. We can find individual cumulonimbus, but we can find also a mesoscale cluster. And all these features are included, of course, in the larger scale, which is the intertropical convergence zone. So basically, we can look at any image of any day of the year, and we will find this feature, but of course they will move in space due to the annual cycle. So basically, the local scale rainfall are mostly of convective origin, as you know. So it is phase-locked with the diurnal cycle, at least over most of the continent, and we have also a periodic forcing associated with the annual cycle of solar radiation. The diurnal convection is, of course, organized by larger phenomena, so from mesoscale cluster, tropical depression cyclone, and the last phenomena is the ITCZ, which are themselves more or less impacted by periodic and quasi-periodic variation. So, of course, if we consider the local scale event, there is a deterministic limit associated with the chaotic dynamics of the atmosphere. On the other side, we know that the seasonal amount at regional scale are more or less predictable, at least from the SST. It includes, of course, the ENSO phenomenon, but it is not limited to. We have also Indian modes or Atlantic modes, which can provide some predictability. And this predictability arises basically from the link between the sea surface temperature with the thermal direct circulation. So as I said yesterday, it creates some regional to zonal scale feature which can be predicted at seasonal time scale. So of course, by definition, when we try to predict a seasonal amount, we are working on the most comprehensive characteristic of the rainy season, because by definition, we include all the rainy events of a given season lasting between 2 to 8 months across the tropics. The problem with the seasonal amount is that there are two problems. It is that there is a theoretical problem and there is a practical issue. The first problem is that when we look at the internal variability of the seasonal amount, we are not sure that it is not dominated by few heavy events. It depends on the area, of course, where we work. But of course, the wettest day of the season, typically you can have during a season 5 or 6 days accounting for between 30 to 60% of the total rainfall. So in fact, when we look at the seasonal amount, we look at these 5 or 6 days specifically. So the seasonal amount could be, in fact, heavily contaminated by small-scale feature. Another limit, which is more a practical limit, is the fact that when we turn into application, the seasonal amount are not necessarily the most awaited variable by end users, as said by Andy yesterday. So, for example, farmers are usually more interested by the onset date for sowing purpose. They are also interested in the duration of the rainy season or the mean length of dry spell for adapting the crop or the variety choice. So as we know that by definition the seasonal amount include all the information, all the other information of the season. But we can assume, and we will see that just after, that the same seasonal amount cannot be necessarily associated with the same scenario across the season. So there is an issue about the cascade from the regional scale predictable component towards the local scale, that is how it is translated. It is a linear way or a non-linear way, and how it is modulated during the season. So I will show you some example of the predictability of interseasonal characteristics, so another acronym, ISC. And I take basically an example on the maritime continent, but I will say a few words about other area. So just an outline. So we will first see what is a typical rainy season in the tropics and possible daily scenario. So of course there is a myriad of daily scenario, but we can just summarize this scenario into few possibilities. Then we will go into the issue of the analytical decomposition of seasonal amount. So basically, we will see that there are two possibilities, and it's basically complementary approach. One, it is the analytical decomposition of seasonal amount into intra-seasonal characteristic. And the other one, it is to construct the typical sub-seasonal scenario, which start from the daily series, time series, to extract the most typical spatially consistent scenario. And the two examples will be applied to the maritime continent. So basically, it is a typical rainy season in the tropics. So we have a season lasting between 3 to 6 months. It could be a little bit shorter, but also longer. But it's a typical season, which is, of course, fixed by the solar radiation. So we have a start, an onset, and the end, a peak of the season. But at daytime scale, it is not always well marked. We have wet spells, sequence of wet spells, and, of course, dry spells. We can have also false onset, that is a short wet spell well behind the real onset and followed by a dry spell, which could be detrimental to too early sowing, for example. Then we can imagine how a negative anomaly at seasonal time scale could be translated into the daily scenario. And of course, it is not trivial, and we can imagine that there are more than one possibility. It could be a systematic frequency, a reduction of the frequency of wet days, so we have longer dry spell in mean. It could be a reduction of daily mean intensity of wet day without any impact on the frequency of the rain. It could be also an anomalous delay of the onset, an anomalous advance of the end. So in both cases, we have a shorter rainy season than in usual. And it could be, of course, any combination of the above anomaly. So we can have a different change in the property of the rainy season. And as shown by Andy yesterday, it could have, of course, a very different impact, for example, on crops. The fact is, we can summarize the situation by this pyramid. That is, we start from the instantaneous local scale rainfall, where we know that, of course, by definition, the interannual or the subseasonal predictability is quite limited. And then we go further into time scale and into space scale to consider the regional scale rainfall amount. So basically, when we consider the current seasonal prediction, this seasonal prediction are issued at the base of the pyramid. And we know that at this base, at this time and spatial scale, we have various periodic forcing or quasi-periodic forcing acting to influence this time and space time scale. And then when we moved to the local scale rainfall, of course, we found other quasi-periodic or periodic forcing as a diurnal cycle. But it's not well established how these, for example, intra-seasonal oscillation impact the intra-seasonal characteristic of the rainy season, or even how these, for example, interannual timescale impact directly this intra-seasonal characteristic. The problem, of course, is that we have two movements. That is, we can assume that when we move to instantaneous local scale rainfall to regional scale rainfall amount, we increase the predictability. But the fact is that from the practical point of view, we decrease the usefulness of the prediction. But it is not well established if these two arrows act in a linear way or in a non-linear way, or if there are thresholds limiting the predictability of several characteristics, or in the other way, perhaps we have still some characteristic at very local scale which could be predictable at very long time scale. So basically, we can try to analyze this pyramid with two complementary approach. One approach is to consider, at first, the regional scale rainfall amount as the object that convey the predictability a priori. And then we can move towards the local scale rainfall by decomposing the seasonal amount into intra-seasonal characteristics, that is considering the onset, the end of the season, frequency of wet spell, mean duration of dry spell, etc. Another approach is an up-bottom approach, that is we start from the daily timescale rainfall, local, and then we construct some data-adaptative subseasonal scenario to go to the regional scale rainfall amount. So it's quite different approach, but I will show you that they, at least for the example of maritime continent, they lead to the same result. So the first approach, it's to very simple analytical decomposition of the seasonal amount. So the first and the most basic decomposition, it is just to consider the number of wet days and the daily mean intensity of rainfall. So we have just the seasonal amount equal to the byproduct between the frequency and the mean intensity of the rain. So, of course, the daily mean intensity is not the rain rate, which is quite different, because, of course, we know that the tropical rainfall, they rarely last just a whole day, but it is just the fact that it could be related to seasonal amount in that way. So, of course, as I said before, the internal variability of the seasonal amount, so S, will be mostly related to the wettest day inside the season. And, of course, this effect will be diluted if you have a long rainy season or if you have a number of wet day or moderate wet day, which can dilute the effect of the daily mean intensity of rainfall. From a dynamical point of view, or physical point of view, we can consider that the frequency of the rain, so of course it's a binary variable, it indicates that the most moist convection is triggered or not, if we assume, of course, that most of the rainfall are convective in nature. While the daily mean intensity could be viewed as an empirical estimate of the intensity of moist convection. So, as I said before, I assume that most of the rainfall are convective. So we can further decompose the frequency of wet days, which is the inverse of the frequency of dry days, of course, by considering the temporal phase of the monsoon, onset and duration, as well as mean length, frequency of dry and wet spells. So we can see that as this flow chart. So here you have the seasonal amount, and here you have the component. So the basic decomposition it is between the frequency of wet days and the daily mean intensity, and here you have the product to give the above or the parent variable. So here it is the basic decomposition, but then you can decompose the frequency component into, for example, the length of the rainy season, which depends on the onset and the end of the season, okay, and the probability of wet day and dry day inside the season. So from this line, you can, of course, go upward to the seasonal amount, but you have analytical relationship between this component and the seasonal amount. And basically, it works through the decomposition of the frequency of the rain. So in that panel, you have different variables, and some of them document the phase of the season. The most important are the onset and the end of the season. And some of them document the wet spell or the dry spell. And for the dry spell and the wet spell, you have always the frequency of the spell and also the duration of the spell. And when you consider the wet spell, of course, you have the daily mean intensity of these spells. So I will show you an example of Indonesia, and I choose almost a perfect example. So, because as said by Andy yesterday, the Borneo, at least the southern part of Borneo, is perhaps the area where the seasonal prediction is the best all over the world. So I choose a very local scale. So I didn't take the rain gauge because there are two missing data. But I took here the daily GPCP data set, and I took a grid point south-east of Borneo around the city of Banjarmasin, which is the main city of the southern of Borneo. So here it is just the annual cycle, so we have wet condition all year around, but we have a strong decrease of rainfall between April, May, and September, October. And we will see first what is the spatial coherence through just a correlation map of the rainfall just by decomposing into the seasonal amount into the frequency and daily mean intensity around the start of the season, that is in the months of September, and during the core of the season, that is the months of January. Because we assume that to get a prediction, we need to get some spatial coherence of anomaly. We assume that a specific wet event or dry event, very specific, would not be predictable at interannual or subseasonal timescale. So here it's a correlation with the GPCP dataset. So I have only 18 years of data. So we need to consider this feature that is quite short. But anyway, so here are the correlations for the seasonal amount, not the seasonal amount, the monthly amount of September, sorry, the frequency of wet days. So I took a threshold of 1 millimeter per day, and the daily mean intensity of rainfall. So we can see that the pattern for the monthly amount and the frequency is very large, and it is typical, of course, as expected, as an ENSO teleconnection pattern, with when we have more rainfall here, we have less rainfall here, less rainfall here. And we see that the frequency pattern is match well with the monthly amount. It is basically the same map, but we have larger correlation. That is, we can assume that the signal-to-noise ratio is better when we look at the frequency than when we look at the seasonal amount. And we can understand that because when we look at the daily mean intensity, you can see that the correlation vanishes almost everywhere, and we didn't have a very large-scale pattern. Of course, the grid point of Banjarmasin is here. So you see that even closer to Banjarmasin, there were no positive correlation around this grid point. So we can consider that in that month, that during the start of the rainy season, the local scale information we have at this station is in fact included in a zonal scale pattern which is connected to ENSO. So we should expect a quite large predictability, even if we consider a local scale feature. And in that month, the daily mean intensity add a noisy pattern to the amount, which is not, of course, present when we look at the frequency. When we look at the same map for January amount frequency and daily mean intensity, we can see that two features, the zonal pattern almost vanish for any variable, that we have nothing on the ENSO, the core of the ENSO area. And we see also that the three pattern, the pattern of intensity is closer to the pattern of the amount than the pattern of the frequency, at least if we consider the Indian, the Eastern Indian Ocean and the Western Pacific Ocean. So it suggests that the predictability, at least the predictability linked to ENSO, is very poor at Banjar Masi in January, while it was quite large at the beginning of the season. So we can then take a look at a very local scale feature that is, and it is an important feature for farmers, it is the onset. So here, it was a paper we published with Andy and Rizal Dibour from Bogor Center of Research. So we look at the local rain gauge. So you see that we have not a lot of local rain gauge, but we look also at the CMAP dataset, the PANTAT CMAP dataset, and we define just the onset. It's an agronomic definition. The first wet day of the first 5 days receiving at least 40 millimeter without 10 days receiving less than 10 millimeter in the following 30 days, just to avoid short wet spell, which are well behind the real onset. So here you have the climatological map. So you can see that there is a shift which can be associated with the shift of the ITCZ from northwest to south-east here. So from it is a quite slow phenomenon, so it lasts from the beginning of September to the late November and even to the early December if we consider northern Australia. And here you have the leading UF of this local scale onset date, so you can see that you have a clear regional scale mode of variation. That is, when the onset is delayed over central Sumatra, it has a good chance to be also delayed 2 or 3 months later on the island of Timor. So basically, we have something which synchronizes the local scale onset across this area. Of course, this feature is ENSO. It's not a big surprise. It's now well established. But just to understand how a general regional or zonal scale feature can influence a local scale feature, I just plot here the condition, the mean condition in September, November, that is the season when the onset occurs from northern Sumatra to Timor and Sunda Island. So here you have the wind at 10 meters and the color are the vertical velocity. So negative value, it means ascendance, and positive value means subsidence in the middle troposphere. So we can see that in that season, in mean, of course, we have wind from north on the north of the equator, but we have still southward wind south of the equator. So still trades quite fast south of the equator. When we look at the correlation with ENSO index, so I use just NINO 3.4, it's synchronous correlation, we see that the pattern of the correlation add the same component to the wind, That is, it is sous-systole anomaly. So basically, when we have a warm and so event, we delay the onset because the trade lasts longer than usual, because the mean anomaly associated with ENSO are the same as the climatological basic state. So we tend to create the condition that this mean situation will last longer than usual. This situation means also, so the color, it is the anomaly of subsidence, so we see that it's very clear a source of the equator. This situation of faster winds than usual, because we add an anomaly which has the same sense as the basic state, means that we will cool the inner sea. So it will play also a role to inhibit the low-level convection in that area. That is, the shift of the ITCZ is inhibited, and you have cooler inner sea in the interior due to faster winds in Indonesia. We can see also that through the weather type, it is just to make a reminder from my talk of yesterday. So we analyze also the weather type across Indonesia. And the onset, here we have made the composite of the weather type frequency during warm and cold ENSO event. And when we look at the onset period, we see that the main difference is the difference between weather type 2, which is here, and the weather type 3, which is here. It's the blue curve, and the weather type 2 is the red curve. So we see that this weather type 2 is still a winter atmospheric situation, that is, we have still trades, and the ITCZ is blocked over Sumatra at sub-equatorial latitude, and also, of course, northwest equatorial Pacific here. But we see that over most of Indonesia, south of equator, the monsoonal Indonesia, we have still in trade circulation, and with anomalous low subsidence with a high, OLR value. But the weather type 3, which is here, you see that the monsoon, the west monsoon, west northwest monsoon, is well established south of the equator, and then we have a very negative value of OLR, which means deep convection across Indonesia. So in warm ENSO event, we stay in this weather type too long, and in cold ENSO event, we switch from this weather type to this one, the core of the monsoon here, weather type 3. So it is a large-scale phenomena, but this large-scale phenomena control the local-scale onset. So in that case, we can predict a local-scale event from a large-scale process. But of course, we need some condition to get such prediction. So basically, the warm ENSO phase induced large-scale subsidence in the middle troposphere, especially south of equator, and low-level easterlies, so correspond to weather type 2 in my classification. And this situation increases the usual trade, and the cool inner sea in the wind speed is increased. And as we know that ENSO is already established in boreal summer, so before the onset across Indonesia, then we have the condition to get a prediction, an accurate prediction of even local scale event. So here I will show you an example, very simple, using linear analysis, which is a canonical correlation analysis. So as you know, perhaps it could be done with tools available at IRI. So here it's the first mode of the canonical correlation mode between the July SST, so well behind the onset in Indonesia, and the onset in Indonesia. So we see that there is a synchronization of the local scale onset So ENSO tend to add a negative anomaly, that is, it delays the onset systematically across the Indonesia. And of course, with that method, we can get a scale of local scale onset, very high south of Borneo, for example. So, as I said before, this approach where we decompose the seasonal amount into fixed intra-seasonal component, it's very easy to do, of course, because it's analytic method. The disadvantage is that as soon as we move to intra-seasonal component, we move, of course, to the unpredictable component in theory. But we see that for Indonesia, we can get some scale even for local scale event. But of course, it is not a trivial result. And we need to look at that, at this decomposition in any area, and to look precisely to which component is predictable or convey most of the predictability of the season. But it could be you know, a family of intra-seasonal components, that is, the predictability could be dispatched on various intra-seasonal characteristics. There is no trivial result about that. So I will present you now another approach, which starts from the daily time scale. That is, we start from the daily time scale, and the idea behind this approach is to look at the variation which are spatially consistent and also temporally consistent across the season. So I will show you an example about Indonesia. So I use the Aphrodite dataset of rainfall. So I first average on running a 31-day window. So it is a parameter. We can change this window. Then I square root this amount to reduce the skewness. Then I normalized this anomaly. And then I construct a time-lagged EOF. So I consider the variation in space, but also inside each season. So I consider the systematic covariation in space, but also inside each season. Then I use a technique which is a fuzzy k-means. So it's basically the same as the hard k-means, except that we have a fuzzy criterion. And it's very important because in that situation, I cluster only 47 years. So it's very low. So I need to not constrain too much the membership to 0 to, or to 1. And it's better in that case. In the case I show you yesterday, we cluster more than 1,000 days. So it's not an issue. But as soon as you move to very small records, it's better to use fuzzy clustering. So the sub-seasonal scenario, so excuse me, I will introduce another acronym, SSS. Are then typical scenario of low-pass rainfall anomaly with the largest mean amplitude records when the anomaly are large. But when you have a noisy pattern, it will decrease the covariance, and then it will filter out in a data-adaptative way the most spatially coherent signal across a season. So here are the five scenarios. So I will return to this issue in the conclusion. So as any clustering, you have to choose a number of clusters. But as for weather type, the final conclusion are not very sensitive to the number of clusters. It's just a matter of interpretation rather than a very strict statistical score. So here you have five scenarios. So here you have the year where the membership to the scenario is above 0.5. The membership is between 0 and 1. So we can say that this year are the typical year for this scenario. Okay? So here you have the date, which are the center of a 31 days period. And here you have the standard deviation of rainfall. So you have a first scenario which is very dry at the beginning of the season, then you turn to close to zero or even positive anomaly at the end of the period. If you look at the other scenario, you can see that the sub-scenario 3 is basically the reverse, that is, you have positive anomaly at the start of the season, and then you turn into zero or even negative anomaly at the end of the season. When you look at the other scenario, these two ones are almost opposed, which is defined by construction, of course, because we are looking at anomaly relatively to a mean. So it's quite expected that we will find quite opposite scenario. So the first, the scenario two, it is null anomaly at the beginning, then mostly positive from mid-October. The scenario five, it is null anomaly till mid-October, then large negative anomaly. The interesting fact, it is that this scenario, this year, are mostly before the 90s, and this year are always after the 90s. So this scenario could be an indication of trend in the rainfall season across Indonesia. And the last scenario, it is the fourth one, and we can see that this scenario, it is mostly positive anomaly across the season. And we see that the spread, the spatial spread, I didn't indicate that, excuse me. So the dashed line is just the spread across the space. By the technique I said before, that is, I use this technique. So I use, I concatenate all the time series in space, okay? And I concatenate this time series also in time. So I have a matrix. In row, I have the year, okay? And in column, I have the space, the grid point of the station. But I have also the intra-seasonal variation, okay? So in that case, we said that we use a time lag DOF, okay? Because in the variable, I have also time, okay? I use all the lags because I put all the season in the variable. Okay, so potentially, if you have a season lasting 6 months, you consider, yes, the lag from 0 to 6 months. Okay, so we can plot the anomaly, of course, in a more usual way. So I just plot here the monthly anomaly for the five scenario for the monthly amount, okay? So here I have the two opposite scenario one, scenario three. So scenario one is dry at the beginning, then close to zero. Scenario three, it's wet at the beginning, close to zero, then after, but we can see that there are some anomalies. For example, in Sulawesi, we have a positive anomaly in this negative anomaly, excuse me, in this scenario in March, April. We see also that scenario 2 and scenario 5 are basically out of phase, and then the strongest anomaly are most in the core for sub-seasonal scenario 5 and at the end of the season in scenario 2. In scenario 4, we are close to the mean, but it's weakly positive across the season. So it is just a matter, it is just a way, excuse me, to extract the sub-seasonal evolution of anomaly, but it is close in spirit to the S2S scheme because we will look at the evolution of the anomaly during a season. Here, it is just the anomaly of sea surface temperature in August. So it's before the season, of course. So you can see it's not a big surprise that the first scenario, it is warm and so event. The third scenario, it is cold and so event. As we know, it's not a big surprise. The scenario 2 and the scenario 5, which are out of phase, so the scenario 2 is mostly wet, the scenario 5 is mostly dry. We can see that also an opposition in the field of the SST anomaly. So I show you only the SST anomaly, which are significant from a Monte Carlo approach. And we can raise the issue that perhaps this scenario could be a fingerprint of the global warming, because we saw that the signal are the strongest where the global warming signal is the strongest in the tropics. And it's important because in that case, for this scenario, I remind you that it is the driest year in Indonesia. Of course, the driest year are not warm and Sawyer. Warm and Sawyer, that is the first scenario, it is a delayed onset, but then after, the anomaly tend to be close to normal, at least over the island. When we look at the anomaly associated with the scenario in January and April, that is during this scenario, we can see that we retrieve, of course, the evolution of the SST anomaly over the inner sea of Indonesia, because if you remind well, the first scenario in August is cold in Indonesia, but then you see that in January and in April it is warm, because we know that the large-scale wind anomaly associated with ENSO, it is easterly anomaly across Indonesia, it cooled down the SST when we are still before the monsoon, because it increased the trade, but then after, it counteracts the westerlies of the monsoon. So as soon as we have moved from, we have shifted from the trade regime to the monsoon regime, there is an inversion of the anomaly in the inner sea. Okay? So it could explain itself the subseasonal modulation of the signal we found, because at the beginning, in the Indonesia, we have cooler sea than usual, so it could increase the dryness with the subsidence. But then after, we have warm anomaly in the inner sea. And we know from the weather type perspective that it corresponds to a specific weather type where the winds are very weak. And when the winds are very weak, we increase the diurnal cycle. So we have something which could link the fact that we have a consistent evolution during the season with a coupled phenomenon of the inner sea that could explain the fact that the anomaly are in fact modulated at subseasonal timescale. So we could try to use that to predict. It's very preliminary, but I tried that already for the area. So basically, it's a cross-validated approach, of course. So basically, I have my step of the definition of subseasonal scenario in cross-validation. So I remove 1 year from the sample, and then I compute the subseasonal scenario. Then I the tier one, so it's a two-tier technique. So one tier is the construction of the statistical model, so I link the subseasonal scenario membership and the leading three PC of tropical SST in August. So I take the SST before the subseasonal scenario. So I use the logistic regression during the training period. So it's the same technique I used yesterday in my talk about weather type. So basically, it's the same as the linear regression, except that you you predict a multinomial category. So then, I get the prediction of the verified year for the scenario I have in the training set. Okay, so I use the SST for the verified year. And the tide, the tier two, is to just resample the observed daily time sequence. So it is a way, you know, to just resample the daily sequence, so we can get any information from the daily sequence, because we start from the daily sequence, and basically it's a way to resample the daily sequence from the predicted membership. So I have a sequence of predicted membership versus observed membership in the training set. So I can do a KNN, K nearest neighbor approach, to resample the predicted membership versus the observed membership in the training set. And then I obtain, by this way, a possible resampling of the observation from the training set to the predicted year. So I just show you a few years for local scale. So it is the grid point at the Banjarmasin from Aphrodite dataset. So the two top years are scenario ENSO year. So here you have the tercile, so the moving tercile across the running 31 days. So it varies, of course. The dots are the prediction. So I made 500 simulation. So the dots are the mean of the prediction. And the black curve, it is the observed rainfall anomaly. So what is interesting is that in the two ENSO years here, so the first scenario, the first observed scenario is, you see, very clear for the first scenario, but it's not one, it is never one, of course. So it's very clear example of ENSO year. Not surprise, of course, but you have very close scenario. And you see that we capture quite well the transition between dry to normal or even positive anomaly. There are some errors, of course. You see that at the end of the 82-83, we are not able to capture the decrease of rainfall in March, April, 83. It's not a big surprise, of course, because we tend to get to have a larger scale at the beginning till the middle of the season. Then we know that in the middle of the season, we have less spatial coherence. And in the late season, of course, we can imagine that considering only the regional scale pieces of tropical SST in August is not enough to have the scale, if any. But what is said by the scenario is that probably the most skillful period is at the beginning of the season because the scenario is well defined during that season and the spread is less than at the end of the season. Just two other figures where in 75-76 you see the membership is close to scenario 3, that is a cold ENSO, but you see that there are other scenarios in that year, so it's not so typical. And the last year, it is 84-85, when we see that the membership to scenario 3, which is the larger for this year, is only 0.5. So of course, the fuzziness allows to have a quite a flexible approach of the evolution of the rainfall anomaly. But in 75, you see still that we capture quite well the transition from very positive to zero or negative anomaly in late November in that case. So we can play the game to the for the upcoming season. So I do the exercise with using the August SST of 2015. Here is the prediction, and in the lower panel, in the right, I put the observation I took yesterday from a CPC. So by chance, Banjarmasin is one of the rare stations available at in Indonesia in real time. So we can see that there are some false onset in Banjarmasin. You see, you have one event in the beginning of October, one event in late October, but the two times we have a dry spell then after. There is one also, we didn't see it, but also in the end of August. But if we follow the prediction, we expect that these are false onsets because the prediction is that the anomaly will turn from very negative to zero around the late November. And you see that, in fact, it seems still with an interrogation, but we think that the onset is on at Banjarmasin, and the actual date of the onset, it is the 11th of November of this year. And you can see, perhaps I am lucky here, but the tendency changed around the 11th of November in my prediction. You can see, of course, that the uncertainty, which is the red and black dots, increase till the end of the season, and we are, of course, far less confident for what will happen at the end of the season. So it is just a prediction of the mean monthly rainfall using this technique. So you see that the negative anomaly follow the shift of the ITCZ. So we have negative anomaly almost on the western part in September, then all the Indonesia is negative in October, then it shifts, it tends to shift to easterly Indonesia, so Sulawesi and Sunda Island in December. But you have still negative anomaly in December for the East Indonesia, but in the remaining part of Indonesia, it should be close to normal or positive anomaly in December. Of course, it's difficult to trust the anomaly in May, because if we look at the uncertainty, it's larger, of course, from March, basically. But we have still some signal of low uncertainty, so it's standard deviation of the prediction. So we have still some signal in March in central Borneo and southern Sumatra. So you can of course, as indicated by Andy yesterday, we can of course generate a probabilistic map. So here I just use a counting frequency in a tercile. I do not use a parametric approach, so it's very basic. So here I just show you the probability of rainfall, monthly rainfall below the first tercile for the same month. So we can see it's not different from the previous math, but just in probabilistic format, we see that the shift of negative anomaly from western and central Indonesia, all Indonesia almost in October, then it shifts toward the southwest. It corresponds to the normal shift of the ITCZ. So to conclude, of course, local scale rainfall, when we say towards the prediction of local scale rainfall, we do not consider, of course, instantaneous rainfall, because by definition they are unpredictable at internal time scale, but we consider the property of local scale, which could be predicted. So how it works physically? It could work through two types of synchronization. The synchronization of first kind, it is basically the integration of individual convective system into larger system. So you can consider that any thunderstorm will be included or not, but it could be included into larger system, instantaneous larger system from mesoscale cluster to ITCZ, which is the larger scale. And you have a second synchronization, which work at an anomalous property, which I call the synchronization of second kind, which is related to systematic modulation of property, phase, frequency, sequentiality, and mean intensity of the rainfall through the scale of motion. So this synchronization could work, in fact, on the larger scale. Well, we can expect that it will work on the larger scale. But if, of course, we have an event, even a local scale one, which is related with a large scale phenomenon, we can get a synchronization of second kind even at local scale. So the idea is to go behind the seasonal amount. So I present some technique, but you can imagine, I think, a lot of technique to do that. Of course, when we look at the current seasonal forecast, we we are mostly dealing mostly with the synchronization of second kind. So seasonal amount have many advantages to include all the rainy events, but this advantage could be a default from the predictable point of view because of the weight, which could be large, of the extreme event. So basically, looking at intra-seasonal characteristic or sub-seasonal scenario target the same goal, that is analyzing the potential predictability beyond the seasonal amount. So the advantage is we go clearly to targeted information for end users. The second advantage is to consider the possible intra-seasonal modulation of potential predictability. But of course, there is also a side effect. The inconvenient is that as soon as we go towards the local scale, we go to the unpredictable component. But we saw that, in fact, the decrease or the relationship between the predictability and scale is not linear. Basically, it's non-linear, and sometimes we still have predictability even at local scale. But to get a predictability at local scale, we need some condition, of course. We need to that the local scale event, even if its synchronization of first kind is small, it does not matter. Okay? It is not a matter of the synchronization of first kind. It is mostly a synchronization of second kind of any event. Okay? So we saw that for the Indonesia, it is the case because the ITCZ is shifted, is delayed in its shift, its usual shift, by the ENSO large-scale anomaly. So we already analyzed other area in the tropics, for example, with Andy, and we found other quite promising signal. For example, in Philippines in May, we still found that the onset seems to be quite predictable. We found also an example in March over East Africa. As said yesterday by Frederick, the March to May seasonal amount of East Africa is not predictable from SST, but in fact, it seems to be linked to the fact that the seasonal amount is dominated by the amount in the months of April and May. And in April and May, it's largely inconsistent across space. But if you look specifically at the amount in February-March, it is more spatially consistent and more predictable. And in fact, it is where the East Africa, it is where we develop the approach of a sub-seasonal scenario initially. So the message is that it is not trivial across the tropical zone. You need to, if you are interested in this issue, you need to look precisely to your area, to your season, and see how it works. And sub-seasonal scenario in that context could be just a way, a tool, to see how it works. So, for example, the onset, unfortunately, is not predictable for other tropical regions, for example, for Sahel. Or India, it seems not so predictable. And for India, it seems that the spatial coherence peak at the end of the season, inside also, but not in the core of the season. A general result, it is that the frequency of wet day is far more spatially consistent than the daily mean intensity of rainfall. So a good thing to do at first, it is to consider the frequency of rainfall rather than the amount of rainfall if you are interested in prediction or predictability issue. It is far more difficult to predict the rainfall amount, but when we look at the frequency, it is usually far better. So the two techniques, they are complementary, I think. The analytical decomposition is very easy to implement. It does not need any technical sophistication. The only parameter at beginning, at start, which is important, it's to define a wet day. Well, I take usually a millimeter. You can test other threshold. It's not very important. It's better to not take a zero threshold because it's subject to error. So it's better to take at least 1 millimeter. Perhaps it's better for some region to take even higher, but 1 millimeter, I think it's a good compromise at the beginning. There is another issue which is not solved, that is the choice of the parameter to define the onset and withdrawal. It's an important issue, and it is important because it will fix the duration of the season. So it's quite important. There are many solutions to define the onset. You have agronomical definition, which is very close to what is weighted by farmers. Or you have more climatic definition, as the Liebman definition, where you look at the cumulative anomaly. I think it's as other purpose where you have a parameter. It needs to be tested to see what's going on for your area. And there are some solutions to increase the signal-to-noise ratio. So the paper of a doctorate, PhD doctorate in Dijon, who tried to test systematically many parameters and to find the most robust signal. So there are always solutions. For subseasonal scenario, you have two parameters, the fuzziness parameter, which is the parameter which be important to scale the fuzziness, and the number of clusters. As for the clustering for weather type, I think it's not a real issue at the end. Of course, it is always an issue because if you define four subseasonal scenarios or five, you will have different solutions. But when you interpret the scenario, I think it's the most important part. And we know that in theory, it does not exist. I think it does not exist a real number that is the goal number of the number of cluster or the fuzziness parameter. So this parameter, I do some experiment, for example, for the skill of rainfall across Indonesia, basically does not change the result. That is, at the end, we got the same skill if we take 4 to 7 cluster. Of course, it's always a matter of robustness. And we have the same result if we decrease a little bit the fuzzy parameter or we increase a little bit the parameter. For the fuzzy parameter, of course, there is a limit because at some point, the fuzziness is too strong. And then you have the same membership for all the year. So in that case, you distribute the fuzziness. In that case, it does not mean anything. So the last message is that there is a sense, of course, to consider that there are some intraseasonal source of modulation, because in fact the internal feature like ENSO, we know that they are modulated at intra-annual timescale. So we can think that there are source of potential predictability which are different across the season. It could be like in Indonesia, where the local scale coupling between ocean and atmosphere changed during the season. But it could be also between the continental surface and the atmosphere during the season. We know, at least for Sahel, and I think that the same feature could occur for India or other continental monsoon area, that there is a buildup of a feedback between the continental surface and the atmosphere during the season, because the track, even if it's stochastic during the season of the wet event, will homogenize the moisture content of the soil, and then it could create a positive feedback to the end of the season. And of course, for example, for Sahel and for India, when you have a season from May to June to September or October, we know that during that season, the ENSO change a lot. and it could change, of course, the potential predictability of the amount of the frequency of rainfall during the season. So the idea is to get into the season, to not stop at the seasonal amount, which is very attractive from a certain point of view, but perhaps it is interesting to go into the season to see if the seasonal amount does not blur some signal which are hidden in the season and which could be useful for end users. So it is just if you want to go further, so some paper I have used to prepare this lecture. Thank you.